Is of project volumes and 3 data center locations. So that is a small overview about our customers. So which we take care of their infrastructure. I go to 2 customers. They are special for us. We are the company there behind the European Energy Exchange. So they have offices in London, in Madrid, or in Paris. And we make the IT infrastructure and the global IT outsourcing and the release management completely for their software and development. And another big customer is a new customer is the medical service of health insurance. This customer is also running completely on cloud stack environment, and it has 15 national associations. And the presentation is based on this customer. So, what we have for challenges and goals, and what was the problems to solve these things. So that's our international certifications. So the ESA 8 certification for outsourcing and TÜV certifications, and I think any companies will have this. So what we are doing? We are active contributor of the CloudSIG community. We try to submit issues, fix bugs and pull requests, and we also support the community actively on the new CloudSIG Primate UI. And we try to support the community when we can. It's not always possible, but if we can do it, we try it. Okay, our goals. The goals was mostly in our company, we try to use open source. So everybody here knows you can use open source, but sometimes you have customers, they have a problem, they need to have regularities to hold, and they need certifications, and you cannot use open source. Sometimes you can use open source, and that's what we try always in projects, to use it when it's useful. The second point is, what's important for the project, and an example on MDK was, we need high performance from the storage. Noisy neighborhood problem is not good for our customers, because the goal of the customer was to get virtual machines running on infrastructure, and in parallel get containers running on the same infrastructure. They need to be connected, and they need to be no neighborhood problem. So because we don't need the performance degradation from the virtual machine to the container and vice versa. What's important? So we need VLAN separation. At the moment, you don't have really VXLAN in CloudSIG. You have VXLAN, but if you use VPC or virtual router, mostly you have VLAN. You can use Linux bridges or OVS, and then you have VLAN. And the thing is, if you wanted to run a Kubernetes or an OpenShift with more features in such an environment, you don't want to route the traffic directly over a VPC. That will be a problem. The VPC will go down, although you have too much traffic to the VPC. High performance is the same like what we need. And what's important for both things, for virtual machines and containers, we need snapshot functionality, because the containers were very large. So we have containers at the end with a database from 1 terabyte or more terabyte of storage. And the problem is you need snapshots. They are fast, and you have to make them like policies every hour or something like that. Then you need a storage which can handle this. Okay, that's the same. Virtual machines, high performance, natural functionality. That's the components what we use. Our data center is built on the following components. It's KVM. We use Open vSwitch because we have good experience with that. I think it's a very stable product, and it's the performance is very good if you tunnel complete traffic and other things through the same switch. That's what we use is two is NetApp and Trident from NetApp. I come later to this thing, and Cumulus Linux. It's an open network operating system. So you can run it on bare metal switches. You have a lot of possibilities to to pair the switches with Ansible, and you can configure it in runtime. You can write your own agent and something like that. For servers, we use QCT, Quanta Computers, and we use OpenShift. Okay, some points to our CloudSig installation. We use KVM, mostly on CentOS or Red Hat Enterprise Linux. It's depend on our on the customers we have. If you have customers, they need to fill out to reach regularities. So then we go to the supported stack, and if you don't we need it, we go to CentOS. Network, we use Open vSwitch with VLAN separation. As primary storage, we use NetApp HCI, yes. And secondary storage, we use normally an active passive NFS storage system. There are different storage systems on the market you can find to use this. As a database, we use MariaDB Galera cluster for the database backend from the CloudSig management server, so that we can take care, because we spread it over 3 data centers, and then we are sure if one server goes down, we have 2 other servers, they can work further for the CloudSig management backend. We don't use really any version of CloudSig, so we are mostly on master. It's not easy, but mostly we need some bug fixes or some features from master, and that's what we are mostly on the actual version. We test it internally on our test environment, and then we will go directly in production. I think it's the modern DevOps name today. And the main features we use in CloudSig is domains projects and the LDAP integration. And last but not least, we use the VPC features. We have heavy use of the private gateway, ACLs, and a NAT, and soon redundant, so we had some problems. I don't know if you have a KVM, maybe other will have the same problem. It will be fixed in one of the next PRs in the on the master. I think there is a PR from Uwe Zhu from LeaseWeb, so he fixed the problem for KVM. If you want a redundant VPC and you have OVS, so you had the problem that only one will run and the other one will lost the IP address on our interface. So you had the management interface and the public address was on the management interface. So this will be fixed in the next time, and then we will switch to the redundant version, because we need this feature to for our customers. Okay, that's the server and the network what we use. We normally use one RU servers with 2 sockets and 768 GB RAM and 2 10 gigabit SFP plus standard networking, and the most servers come today with one NVMe or SATA DOM. And for switches we use Edge Core. You can also use QCT, that's no problem. That's bare metal switches, and we put the Cumulus Linux as a network operating system on it. I think it's the best. It's good if you want to customize your network, and it's good if you want the best price for a port. Okay, I spoke about NetApp AGI, and I have a nice picture here. That's the storage system what we use. You see here, NetApp AGI is very scalable. You can start with 4 nodes, and we have any of these nodes in our data center, and you can grow up linear. And you can also use compute nodes, but we only use the storage nodes. You can use them with 10 gigabit or 25 gigabit, and you have management ports, and it's a complete system. In 2 units, rack units, and 1 rack units, I know. Okay, that's the thing on the front. That's the storage system from the front. You see here that you have the metadata drive, and the rest always the disk drive. You have 4 storage nodes into, and you have here your disk space. It's like, the vendors, they produce this is made mostly other great vendors. They are behind this Supermicro or something like that. They produce the hardware for them. Why we choose NetApp? So that is a product view direct from the user interface from NetApp. So you can specify the IOPS you want for a virtual machine or later for container, and you see it here. You can put the min IOPS and the max IOPS and the burst IOPS into, and you have the possibility. Maybe you have a virtual machine like a Windows machine, and they start up, they get the burst. It's very, very fast in the startup, and then you have over the runtime this IOPS here guaranteed. And it's a guarantee system. That means these machines will always have this IOPS. The system will guarantee it. And you can have different policies and IOPS. Okay. One point which is important, so if you have many systems and the systems are down in the night or they will start up in the morning, it can also be a VDI, virtual desktop environment, then you have the problem of a boot storm. So the people come in the office and they start the virtual machines will starting, and then the boot storm is coming and the storage will go down. That's a typical problem what you have if you have many virtual machines. This is if you have a storage, they have enough IOPS. Mostly the most customers have not a storage. They have enough IOPS. They have IOPS, but they have to share it over the customers. So then you will get problems. But with a solid file system, you don't get these problems because they have a QoS system and they guarantee that this virtual machine will produce a neighborhood problem with the container or the other virtual machine. Yeah. If you want to use, that's a main point why we use NetApp AGI, is if you want to use a Kubernetes cluster or you want to use OpenShift, then you need an provider for the storage. NetApp is one of the companies, they produce an Trident. Trident is open source. It's a Kubernetes integration for NetApp storage. You can use any NetApp storage from NetApp. It can be a FASB, it can be a solid file, and you can use this provisioner to integrate it in your Kubernetes cluster. Maybe it's a Kubernetes cluster, it's managed by your own, so you need enough stuff to install your own Kubernetes cluster, but you can use this plugin, or you have a enterprise OpenShift or Origin installation. Okay, that's our data center design. So it's only a simple picture. So we are spread, our complete infrastructure is with dark fiber spread over three data centers. So that means we have the NetApp system spread over all data center, and they are synchronous replication, in synchronous replication mode. So there is no active passive modes, all things always active. And we have enough KVM hosts in this data center, in the second and the third data center, and the complete management is spread over the complete environment. So the CloudSec management controls the complete environment. And that is only possible active systems. You know, if you can have a NetApp fast system, a Metro cluster maybe, or you can use, then you have three data center location. But if you want three data center location, you can also use the NetApp solid file, and they have a rack awareness, so they know where the data is located, and you can get a downtime or a failure, and your data are safe, and you can work further, because there is a redirection mode. If one storage go down, over the iSCSI protocol, the iSCSI sessions will be redirected to the other storage nodes in runtime, and then you can go further. Okay, our project network design, I think we build all infrastructures at the moment this way, is that we use CloudStack VPC as our main router for incoming traffic. So mostly our customers have a lease line or have an external VPN to us, and then we route them directly to VPC, and the customer traffic will come with public, not directly on the OpenShift cluster or in this environment where the virtual machines are located. And what we also use is the internal traffic over private gateway. So that means on our network engineers mostly have different zones because we have Critis applications, and they build different zones, and internal traffic will route it over the private gateway from VPC, and external traffic come only this way. So what you see here is a typical OpenShift cluster. For a normal OpenShift cluster, you need three master and three infrastructure nodes, and then the worker nodes. I don't know if anyone knows Kubernetes cluster. You need the etcd cluster. The etcd cluster is located here on this master nodes. The infrastructure nodes will hold the routers and for ingress and outgress for the containers, and the worker will run the applications from the customers. That's only the worker. So. Yeah, and that's a VPC network where the virtual machines are connected. How we provisioning our setup? So we thought about to use the DNS and DHCP server from VPC, but most of our customers want an identity management system and have complex rules and change passwords every 90 days or every monthly. It's up to the customer. And so so we thought about to get a complete system all in one. So we have decided us to use Foreman and Catello, formerly named from Red Hat as Red Hat Satellite. Because you can provision things over PXE, and there is a little bit gap, because if you want to start virtual machines in PXE, there is at the moment, so what we know, no possibility to start it with. So we have our own ISO what we use. That means we create the virtual machines automatically with a script, and we can also use Ansible or Terraform, and then we put the PXE ISO into, and the Foreman server will pick up the virtual machines, will start, will give them a complete DNS authority from this space here, yeah, and will register them automatically in Red Hat EDM. It's an identity management system, and then we can directly push the policies on all Linux machines directly down. And that's our workflow. So first start with PXE, then start the virtual machines, PXE, then will be completely installed with Kickstart, and they are ready. So after that, we will install the complete cluster. And the main thing was, so we don't want routed traffic. So that means in a NetApp system, it's also possible to, you can bridge the storage in each VLAN what you want. So if you have a VLAN, maybe VLAN 2000 here in the VPC network, then we can directly set the solid file with a special user in this network, and we can directly consume the storage services. So that means that it's a picture you see from our environment. You see here the nodes, they are installed, the master and the nodes and the infras. The nodes are the workers for information. And the main thing is, we know that NetApp has a perfect supported integration in CloudStack. So, but they have also the Trident plugin. And if it's possible to bring this NetApp storage directly in this VLAN, so we can directly consume without any routing or without any VPC, the NetApp storage, and we can also provision directly the containers from the OpenShift platform. You can also use the Kubernetes platform. That's also possible. And for this, it will be in the first installation, there will be on the NetApp system installed a Trident pod with our own special pod. They handle the requests for new physical volumes for the containers, and it's like the plug-in from NetApp for CloudStack. I think it's the same, no, for containers. Okay. Some practical things, how you can add a primary storage. I think there is a nice guide from Andrija on the ShapeBlue side. There is a nice guide for SolidFire, and I think also for VMware and other yeah. And I have only a small guide for how do you add a SolidFire system in CloudStack. Yeah, you have in SolidFire system you have always a management virtual IP and a storage virtual IP because it's a cluster. So when you leave a when you lost a node or a chassis, that you have always a connection to your cluster, and you have a user, an admin, the minimum IOPS, the maximal IOPS, and you have a burst mode. The burst mode we saw in any slides before. What you want to have at the moment, it's only possible that's to give. A percentage of the IOPS, so it will calculate the IOPS with this 6.5, and then you have the burst mode. You can put the things here, these values completely as a string into the URL. You have to set your zone, the name of your SolidFire, that's a SolidFire system, and the capacity of your IOPS that CloudStack can calculate it, and yeah, and the string, and then you can add the storage, and you will see it here. It comes up, and then you can directly use it. Before you can use it, you need to create an offer for this. Here is a very small example, maybe 5 GB, minimum 150 IOPS, and maximum 2,050 in burst. And burst is only written. It's calculated from us by self, the disk size, and then you add this offer, and you can use it. So this is like a NetApp looks like. I will go here. You see here if you create a new virtual machine on CloudStack, you will see here mostly the root drive. If you have a data drive, then you can read your data, and you see CloudStack _ Mike Dutowski developed it, and then you have account ID, the UUID, and the account ID from the database. You see here read and write the size of this volume, and then and how much snapshots you have and how it's used, and that is how we created the NetApp. Is a completely has no console, no console for the customer. You can only use API. It's only API driven. You can do all things with an API call. You can do it with CloudStack, but you can also use a curl command or Ansible script. It's also possible. What you see here, if it's created, you see here the what we spoke about the policy. You see 150 IOPS minimum, maximum 2,050, and the burst, and the volume ID and some information. By the way, router VMs, virtual routers, or system VMs, they will be created with a very high min and max IOPS and burst mode because they need to start very fast, and that's why they're so created. Most in the time they don't need it. Okay, that's some things what we look for is if you want to see this in the database. In the database, you will see how in the storage pool database you see how a NetApp system is installed at the moment. You see here the string, and for us in the next time, I think we will think about to implement the burst mode in a separate field so that we can set the burst mode for each customer, for each policy. At the moment you have only this calculation value, and it's set in the storage pool details database, and maybe we will extend it in the next in this year, I think. Okay, yeah. Some practical things to Trident. Trident you can download directly on GitHub. You will find it there. I think you get also if you want to try a SolidFire system. I know there is an image what you can download. You can install it on a VMware, and you can try it with CloudStack, and can test it. And you can also test it then with a Kubernetes cluster or the OpenShift cluster. That's Trident, the Trident installer. You download it. You see the Trident CTL. What you need is for Trident, you need a storage class, a backend. Yeah, a backend, or the backend means what is your storage? It's iSCSI protocol, support from iSCSI, a user from the storage, and the tenant name. And you can give here the policies, bronze, silver, gold, what you want, and then you install completely with this command the storage backend with the policies completely in your Kubernetes cluster or OpenShift cluster. You see after that, you see here OpenShift monitoring Prometheus. It's a Prometheus. OpenShift has its own Prometheus pod, and you see it will be automatically provisioned also on the storage system. You see the usage and the snapshots and so on. And you see here the policies, they will be directly pushed to the storage system. Okay, that's a view from OpenShift. And after you have installed it, you can see here that you have your solid fire bronze, silver, gold, and you can create your storage, what you want, the size. Okay. Last things what we had in our journey, I think, was the snapshot functionality. SolidFire, if you use KVM, you know it's a raw disk. SolidFire has raw disks, you can make snapshots. But the snapshots are hard snapshots. That means there is no VSS or something like that. So because if you have an Exchange or customers, they say, oh, I have Exchange, I have a MySQL, so what I can do, and you snapshot them, then you get a problem. And most customers, if they have such a system, they have two things. They have an agent, or they have a different backup software, or they have the possibility to use VSS. And the main problem is if you have a SolidFire, it's only the snapshot. There will not the machine has no file system consistency. You cannot bring them in the hold mode. And for this SolidFire, NetApp will give us a plugin. It's a plugin for a VSS provider for a virtual machine. And then you will see here it will directly connected to the SolidFire system. But it's from security point, it's not so nice, because if you have customers, they are the SolidFire system is stacked directly in their environment, and that's not good, because normally the storage systems should not in the network system of your customers. And for this, it's interesting, thanks to StorePool. This feature, I think, will help many people. They have a managed storage, because it adds, if it's done, it adds some possibilities to use in raw format to squeeze the virtual machine. Last sort of things. If you want an USB ship, container ship, then you can email to our colleague from Timo Aswad from NetApp. And upcoming projects. I don't forget. We talked about the SDN. So we wrote a mail to the development list. So the main problem what we had is our network guys using Cumulus Linux, and they like VRFs, they like BGP, they like VXLAN, and then you have a problem. You have a virtual router or VPC, and you have a complex network, and they have always problems to bring things together. So that's why Simon Weller and me, we talked over time about this problem, and so we will In the next month, we will write the design down, and we hope the community will come into and help and implement the tungsten fabric. It will not be easy, I need to say. It's not only it's there, but we have to test many things. But then after that, you have an alternative for a complexer networks. Tungsten fabric, everyone can look what is tungsten fabric. It's from OpenContrail, the free version which is moved from Juniper to Free Software Foundation. So, and this SDN will offer VRFs, BGP, and some things what you need to bring it together with a modern other network infrastructure. Yeah. Okay. I think it's time for a beer. Thank you.